Father Beth, who's come to hear your bands this morning.
Yes.
Great to see you. And welcome also to those who are either listening on a live stream or are listening a bit later on in the week on our YouTube recording. No doubt by then you will know the results of the match. Okay, so you all should have a service booklet and also an orange booklet, book rather, with your hymns in, and also if you reply in the bits in bold. So we greet each other in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
The Gospel calls us to turn away from sin and be faithful to Christ. As we offer ourselves to him in penitence, renew our confidence and trust in his mercy. So just spend a few moments calling to mind those things that we want to see, say sorry to God. Jesus Christ, Amen. So please be seated for our first reading.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Thus says the Lord, maintain justice and do what is right. For soon my salvation will come, and my deliverance will be revealed. And the foreigners who join themselves to the Lord, to minister to him, to love the name of the Lord, and to be his servants, all who keep the Sabbath and do not profane it, and hold fast my covenant, these I will bring to my holy mountain, and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices will be accepted on my altar, for my house shall be called a house of prayer for all peoples. Thus says the Lord God, who gathers the outcasts of Israel, I will gather others to them besides those already gathered. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our second reading is from Romans 11, 1-2a, 29-32. A reading from the letter of Paul to the Romans. I ask then, has God rejected his people? By no means. I myself am an Israelite, a descendant of Abraham, a member of the tribe of Benjamin. God has not rejected his people whom he foreknew, for the gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable, just as you were once disobedient to God, but have now received mercy because of their disobedience. So they have now been disobedient, in order that, by the mercy shown to you, they too may now receive mercy. For God has imprisoned all in disobedience, so that he may be merciful to all. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Now going to stand to sing our next hymn, number 323, In Heavenly Love Abiding. So let's start.
Thank you.
remain standing for our Gospel reading. Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus went away to the district of Tyre and Sidon. A Canaanite woman from that region came out and started shouting, "Have mercy on me, Lord, Son of David. My daughter is tormented by a demon." But he did not answer her at all. And his disciples came and urged him, saying, "Send her away, for she keeps shouting after us." He answered, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." But she came and knelt before him, saying, "Lord, help me." He answered, "It is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." She said, "Yes, Lord, yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table." Then Jesus answered her, "Woman, great is your faith. Let it be done for you as you wish." And her daughter was healed instantly. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you,
Christ. Please be seated. So let us pray. The words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts here present be acceptable to you, our Lord and Saviour. Amen. Well, this is one of those weeks where it's not an easy gospel reading this week. It's the story from Matthew's gospel of a Canaanite woman who wants healing for her daughter from Jesus. Jesus, though, doesn't want to give her what she wants, because she's not one of the lost sheep of the house of Israel. He rejects her, but in the end, she persuades him. First of all, though, a story, and it's a story that we've heard of all too often, particularly in the US. I read this week of a quiet university town in the United States, Charlottesville, Virginia, which was engulfed in terrible violence and the outpouring of a disgusting racial hatred. Emboldened by white supremacists took to the streets, carrying offensive banners and uttering vile slogans. The counter-demonstrators gathered in a Baptist church for a dawn prayer meeting before taking to the streets to counter the racial hatred. Many ministers and priests of the Christian church were amongst those opposing the outpouring of racial abuse. Clearly, Christians were on the side of good guys in all this, promoting racial harmony, integration and equality. It therefore comes as a surprise to hear the words of Jesus in today's gospel. "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." And to the Canaanite woman directly, "It's not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." Here is Jesus demonstrating racism. His mission, he says, is only for the Jews. And using the common term of abuse for the Canaanites, he refers to the woman as a dog. It's shocking. In the first half of our Gospel reading, Jesus says that what comes out of our mouth, the words we speak, comes from the heart and shows our true selves. And if in the heart there's evil, that will come out in our speech and defile us. And then his own words appear to demonstrate that deep in his heart are racist attitudes to the Canaanites. Well, it's difficult for us sometimes to grasp the humanity of Jesus. He's both human and divine, but his humanity is often portrayed as perfection. That terrible line in the Christmas carol, away in the manger, clearly demonstrates that idealisation of Jesus the man. The cattle are lowing, the baby awakes, but little Lord Jesus, no crying he makes. Well, in course he cried like any other baby, when he was hungry, had a wet nappy, or was frightened by a noise. He was fully human. And his humanity extended to having the mindset of the community from which he'd sprung. The Canaanites, the people who were in the land of Israel before the Hebrews came from Egypt, had been conquered and were looked down on as the lowest of the low. Dogs was the word for them. And Jesus uses it too. Now the Israelites call the Canaanites dogs, and Jesus seems to be exposing that in his heart. He's taken on his community's attitudes of Israelite supremacy. But the story doesn't end with the rejection and the insult. This Canaanite woman is such a remarkable person, so remarkable that she changes Jesus' thinking and challenges his view of his mission. The mindset he automatically has from his community and his upbringing is challenged and turned around, because she will no longer take a no for an answer. And as a punchline to rock Jesus out of his complacent racism. She's an outsider on three counts. First of all, she's a Canaanite. Then she's a woman. And she has a daughter tormented with a demon. Three reasons to make her an outsider and unclean in Jewish eyes. Jesus just blanks her when she calls out to him for mercy. His disciples go further and ask Jesus to send her away. Well, he doesn't do that, but makes it clear his mission is only for his own people. Only for them has he got mercy to show. But the woman is having none of it. I can't imagine the courage, or perhaps the desperation, she feels that she comes in front of this man who has blanked her, dealt with her as a non-person, and blocks his way by kneeling right in front of him and pleading again, "Lord, help me." And then she and Jesus have this exchange of words, so important that they change Jesus' view of his mission. Jesus says, "It is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." And she retorts with a brilliant punchline, "Even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from the master's table." Words so important in Christian history that they entered our liturgy. Words that we say when we come to the prayer after communion, leading up to communion, our prayer of humble access. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under our table. So to our modern ears, it can seem so strange that a woman had to accept her status, basically grovel before Jesus, and use of herself the term dog. But try to hear the courageousness of this woman, who was desperate for her daughter to get well, and was willing to override all taboos of her society and get attention from this preacher, this healer, this man called Jesus. To understand and appreciate this story, we have to get into the mindset of the community in its time and place. And also to understand the community for whom Matthew was writing. His community was predominantly Jewish, but with increasing numbers of Gentiles joining it. He wanted to reassure the Jewish part of the congregation that Jesus did come for them, but he also needed to widen their horizons and help them to be inclusive. It's not so different a situation to that of many churches and society around us. In Swindon, not far from here, there's a huge Goan community. So much so that the Catholic Church has had to put on a separate mass for them all. In the States, there's been such a turnaround in attitude towards the civil rights movement of the last century that monuments to honour heroes of the past have become blatant symbols of white supremacism and enslavement of the black population and have been pulled down. There was also a similar case in Bristol fairly recently. Attitudes change, both in societies and individuals. Attitudes change even in Jesus, certainly in the Jesus Matthew presents to us. In Matthew's Gospel from this point, although there's still a great concern for the lost of Israel, there's a change of tone. There will be a feeding of 4,000 in Gentile territory, unlike the earlier feeding of the 5,000 in Jewish territory. There will be the parable of the great wedding banquet, where outsiders will be invited in, because the chosen, the invited guests, are not worthy. And this gospel will end with the Great Commission, where the risen Jesus commands his disciples to go out and make disciples of all nations. If Jesus had things in his heart which came out in cruel words, how much more must we have things in our hearts which may come out in hurtful speech? What comes out of our mouths reflects what's in our hearts. And if what is in our hearts is prejudice, anger, envy, feelings of superiority, things which maybe are buried deep within us and we do not fully recognise, then what comes out of our mouths will defy us. But we know Jesus too carried the prejudices of his day within him, but was willing to be challenged and changed, so that he brought good news of love and peace and healing, not just to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, but to all the nations and peoples of the world. Amen. We're going to stand now and join in the words of the Creed, which is on page 5. So let's profess our faith in the living God.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, all that is seen and unseen. We believe in our Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten and not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified and Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory
pray for the church and the world, and let us thank God for his goodness. We pray for your church throughout the world, for Justin and Stephen, our archbishops, and for Stephen, Karen and Andrew, our bishops. In the Martin Vale Benefice, we pray for Teresa and our church wardens who are managing the interim period before our new rector, Reverend Casper Bush, takes over the reins next month. For all neighbouring and retired clergy who are assisting with services, for Enid and Stephen, our licensed lay ministers, for Jack and Mary, our lay worship leaders, our LPAs, and all who assist in maintaining our patterns of worship and support for the parishes. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for all those areas of the world suffering from conflict, war, and natural disasters. For those made homeless as a result. We pray for all those areas of the world suffering from wildfires and for the brave souls who are trying to contain them and lessen their impact. We pray for the Christians in Pakistan suffering for their faith. Our prayers are asked for Myanmar, still suffering from the seemingly endless civil war in that country, and at this time also coping with the devastation caused by seasonal monsoon. We hold up to you in prayer the province of Papa An, their bishop, Joanna Doe, her clergy and people. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, please guide the leaders of all nations in the ways of justice, peace, respect for the environment and their fellow men. Please, Lord, instill a sense of urgency into all those working and agreeing measures to reduce the impact of climate change, and our past lack of care for this precious planet. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for our local community, that all who are able to take some vacation will return refreshed and reinvigorated to do your will. We pray for those unable to take a holiday, for whatever reason. We pray for our children and young people as they start preparing for a new class, school, college, or the start of their working life. Help us support and direct them through whatever transition they face. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for all those sick and suffering in mind, body, or spirit, those known to us and those known only to you. Our prayers are requested for all those on our parish list. Mark Steele, Christine Gundry, Mark Jennings, Lynn Cottrell, Rob Simons, Jacob Malloy Paul Grayford, Liz Kinch, Doreen Williams, Sonia Strange, Judy Scott, Amelia Bottom, Ken Butcher, Alex Grenfell, Caroline Ransom,
Cheryl Heaton, Christopher, Connor, Reverend Craig Manley, Curtis, Debbie Smith, Eddie and Teresa Elliott, Gough Morris, Jennifer Fenton, John Kell, Callie Davey, Nicola Rigby, Rex Hitchens, Henry Warren, and Thomas. For those mourning the loss of loved ones, we ask for comfort and support, especially praying for the friends and relatives of the recently departed, including Danny Fowler, and for all those whose anniversary of death falls this week. We think especially of the family and friends of Ryan, Corinne, Matthew, and Jordan at this time. Merciful Father,
accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ.
To read this week. I published the banns of marriage between Kean William Enderby and Sarah Jane Louise Hanlon. If any of you know, this is for the second time of asking. They are both of this parish with a qualifying connection with St Mary's Tenby. This is for the second time of asking. If any of you know any reason in law why these persons may not marry each other, you are to declare it now. And I see that Beth, we read yours for the third time last week. So I think Ennie did it last week. So good that you're. So I will sign that. Okay, so let's stand. So we prepare to share the peace together. During our hymn in a moment, we'll be bringing the collection forward. If you haven't already managed to put something in the plate at the back there, that's an opportunity for you to do that. Christ is our peace. He has reconciled us to God in one body by the cross. We meet in his name and share his peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Let's pass on a sign of that, please.
Thank you. We live in the flesh of the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
Father, we give you thanks and praise through your very Son, Jesus Christ, your living Word, through whom you have created all things, who was sent by you in your great goodness to be our Saviour. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh. As your Son, born of the Blessed Virgin, he lived on earth and went about among us. He opened wide his arms for us on the cross. He put an end to death by dying for us, and revealed the resurrection by rising to new life. To so we fulfilled your will and won for you a holy people. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and singing.
Share the body of Christ.
Though we are many, we are one body, as we will be
Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you all this week and always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ.